So the first question is evolution as a religion, or we can say atheism as a religion. And the reason why I have this is because last time we talked, there were some of my atheist friends were upset with me because they said, because you said that atheism is a religion or even evolution is a religion, and that upsets a lot of atheists because they figure, you know, they want nothing to do with religion. So I thought we'd talk about that for a little bit. So, yeah, I know you, is that a claim you like to throw out there, that evolution and atheism is a religion?
Oh, absolutely. Evolution. You have to define two words in that sentence. So, what do you mean by evolution and what do you mean by religion? Standard dictionary definition of religion is a belief or belief system on how the world got here. Is kind of, you know, how, there's many different religions in the world, obviously. how did we get here? So, it's something you believe as opposed to science, which is testable, observable, demonstrable in a laboratory, for example. Evolution has six different meanings to the word. I cover this in my seminar, part four. You'd have to have cosmic evolution, the origin of time, space, matter. You'd have to have chemical evolution, the origin of all the chemicals. Then you'd have to have stellar evolution. All the stars would have to evolve. You'd have to have organic evolution. Life would have to start from non-living material. You'd have to have macroevolution, where this life form changed to different kinds of life. And then you have microevolution, which is changes within the kind, like dogs and wolves probably have a common ancestor. Only number six on that list, microevolution, is actually science. All the other five are religious. So when I use the word evolution, I am not referring to minor variations within the same kind. Darwin wrote a book called The Origin of Species. The argument is really not about speciation, it's about kinds. Where do the kinds come from? There are 900 species of bats in the world. They probably had a common ancestor.
Well, okay, before you go off on another topic, how about we'll address what you've said already? So
Okay, sure.
how many different types of evolution did you say there were? Six?
I put it in six
Okay.
different sections, totally unrelated categories.
Okay, so of all those kinds of evolution, which one do you think is the least scientific or the most religious? Which one is basically, which one is your best case for your argument, you think?
I think all five of the top five are purely religious. No one has ever seen a dog produce a non-dog,
But
so that would be in the macro.
why would you expect that? Because according to the theory of evolution, you wouldn't expect to see that.
Well, do you believe dogs came from something ultimately that was non-dog if you go back long enough, far enough ago in time?
Sure, like even humans came from fish and other animals before that.
Well, and that you're welcome to believe that, but that's my point. That's a religious belief. That's not scientifically observable. We have humans having babies all the time, and they're always human.
Well, of
Dogs have
course,
puppies all the time, and they're always dogs.
But according to the theory of evolution, you wouldn't expect it to be observable. So that can't be a mark against it if you can't observe it.
Well, my point is, then it's not typical science. Look up the definition of science. Science from the Latin word "scire," to know. Things that we know by observation, testing, experimentation. Can you do some observation to see an animal produce a different kind?
No, but
Why would you believe
well,
a dog?
you don't always have to directly see things. I mean, deductive logic plays a really big role in it. I mean, for example, you can't see your fingernails growing, but we know they grow with logic.
Well, actually, you could see them grow. You could document that example. You cannot see or document dogs coming from non-dogs, or dogs and bananas having a common ancestor.
But
That isn't that, that, nobody documents that.
you can't see your fingernails growing. They grow too slow.
Well, I could take a picture every day of my fingernails, and in probably, I think, 3 months, it grows from cuticle to cutting length, as typical for your fingernails, and about 6 months for the toenail.
But what if somebody said, that's just one theory? Actually, what happens is every hour God makes it just pop out another small millimeter or whatever.
Well, this is where you have to first define what you mean by science. And so I think the standard definition in any dictionary is going to be seer, to know. What do we know by observation, experimentation, and testing? You don't know that dogs came from a common ancestor with tomatoes. You can believe that, but nobody knows that. You can't know such a thing. That's purely religious, which is my point.
But I mean, personally, for me, I know there's a pseudogene argument, and that alone, when you look at the genomes of the DNA sequences across different species, and you see what happens across species, to me alone, that is enough evidence. And then there's also other evidence in the DNA, like fused human chromosome number 2. And to me, those are overwhelming evidence. So, well, I mean, so maybe when you say you don't know it, maybe it's because you don't know what the biologists know. Maybe the knowing is on your part for not being educated in modern biology.
Well, certainly I'm willing to listen to that. I did teach high school biology 15 years, but as far as pseudogenes, what you're doing is you're looking at one gene in the human gene code. One gene is more complex than any computer program ever written by Microsoft, ever.
I don't think that's appropriate to compare a gene to computer code.
It's an illustration to help people understand. The computer code is a list of instructions to tell the computer what to do. The genes are a list of instructions to tell the cell what to do. How to metabolize, how to grow, how to reproduce.
Sure, but the biological code is nothing like computer code. I mean, the ATCG and the DNA, the way it codes like codons for amino acids, the way that's a coding, there's no parallel to that in computer science.
Well, yeah, there is. See, the computer is just binary code, 1, 0, whereas the CATG is 4. By using 4 base pairs, it gives it trillions of times more complexity available in the gene code, which was my point. The single gene is more complicated than any computer program written by Microsoft or anybody else or Apple.
But let's say if you take a gene, like the gene for eye color, there is actually no such thing as one gene. Every gene, there's like what they call a gene pool. There's every gene is a little bit different, and there's a high probability of certain genes. That's why you can say this gene pool has mostly blue-eyed or whatever. But then when you look across species, you can see how those bits in the DNA code change a little bit.
I agree. I think if I looked at all the lines of code for Microsoft PowerPoint and compared it to the lines of code for Microsoft Word, we would find thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of identical lines of code. Probably they both go to the same spell check database. Okay, what's that proof of? That's proof they got the same designer. If there are similar codes between our DNA and a chimpanzee DNA and a tomato DNA, it doesn't prove a common ancestor. It proves a common designer of the code.
The problem is with comparing it there. I mean, the code for Microsoft, for example, is specific code. It doesn't change ever by one little bit, like one. You can change the DNA code by many bits and have the same exact amino acid sequence because there's so much redundancy in the codon pairing, the codon to amino acid. There are multiple ways to code the same exact amino acid. So if you change one bit, there's absolutely no change whatsoever in the amino acid, which means the code can change. And that's the way our code is in our body. They're all a little bit different, and sometimes they have the exact same amino acids. But the programs are nothing like that. Program is exactly ones and zeros, and they're exactly, there's exact code. They don't change little bits here and there.
But you're missing the point. The complexity of the human genome is many orders of magnitude beyond the simple ones and zeros of binary code for computers. And that is evidence of an intelligent designer.
I don't know if that's I don't know if that's fair to say, because that's hard to measure complexity, because we have computer code that can do things that humans can't do at all. I mean, like supercomputers can blow away humans on certain calculations and things. Like they can simulate a nuclear weapon blowing up. I mean, what do you mean by complexity? I mean, it's a difficult argument to make because they're just apples and oranges, it seems like.
That's why you have to define the terms. That's what I've been trying to do. Science is things we can observe, study, test, demonstrate. We don't observe dogs produce non-dogs ever. Every farmer in the world counts on evolution not happening. He crosses his cows, he expects a calf. You know, he plants corn, he expects corn. Now, there may be varieties of corn, like I don't know how many hundred varieties there are, but they're still corn, and they're recognizable as corn. There's varieties of dogs, Chihuahuas to Great Danes, but the variations within any of the kinds have limits. And the further you get away from the norm, the more problems you're going to have. Like, for instance, cows that give 100 pounds of milk a day. Yeah, but you got to babysit the dumb thing. It would never survive in the wild. So you can selectively breed for more milk production, but you're going to lose in something else, in viability. So what we observe is cows produce cows, dogs produce dogs. There simply are no exceptions in known history.
Okay.
So if you want to believe, I think your choice is to believe that cows and bananas are related. That is a religion in every sense of the word. It's something you believe in. Maybe you believe it very strongly. I don't question that. But the point is, it's not science. Evolution is not science. It's nonsense, in my opinion, but it's certainly not science. It's a religious
belief. Let me summarize with a dictionary definition here, and then I'll give you a chance to some rebuttal if you want to. But so on a dictionary definition I got up online here from the Oxford English Dictionary, it says, religion, number one, the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods. For example, in the sentence, ideas about the relationship between science and religion. 1.1 is a particular system of faith and worship, for example, saying the world's great religions. And then another definition, 1.2, a pursuit of interest to which someone describes supreme importance. For example, consumerism is the new religion. So from my perspective, I could see how religion could be used in either way. I understand totally if an atheist says, do not call this a religion because I do not believe in God and I think it's all fairy tale. And so I can see that point. And I could also see the point where you can say it's a religion because it's something that somebody deeply believes. And so to me, I don't really care about the whole thing. So, but I wanted to throw that in there. So how about some closing comments for you, and then we'll move on to the next one.
Well, there's no question the evolutionists deeply believe that cows and tomatoes are related. They believe it. They really do believe it. I don't question that. And they're constantly looking for evidence to support their belief, which is normal for every religion to do, to look for evidence to support their belief. But it's not science, and it should not be taught in public school textbooks at public taxpayer expense. Evolution should only be taught in private schools where people want to pay and come learn it. As it is now, we're forcing everybody to pay to have one religion taught in the school system. It's completely unfair, unconstitutional, immoral, in my humble, totally unbiased opinion.
Okay. Can we go on to the next one now? Next subject?
Sure.